from South Bend, Indiana, Mayor Pete Buttigieg is about to address the gathering. This is live coverage on C-SPAN 2.
Good morning, and thank you. Thank you, Reverend Jackson, for your leadership. Thank you for the work of the Rainbow Push Coalition, and yes, thank you for this morning, an opportunity certainly for me to become better educated, not only about the challenges, but about the extraordinary capacities of minority contractors in this area that reflects on the challenges and capacities for minority enterprise across the country. It is educational, it will inform my work going forward, and I'm grateful for it. I'm delighted to be in the city of Lori Lightfoot, a trailblazer and an inspiration, and congratulate her on joining the community of U.S. mayors. I'm honored to be in the presence of Whip James Clyburn, who clearly has a kind of biblical favor upon him, because at the fish fry that he hosted a few days ago, they did not run out of fish, even after feeding literally thousands of Democratic candidates for president. So congratulations to you. If you leave this hotel and pick up Lakeshore Drive and take it down Stony Island to the Skyway and across onto the Indiana Toll Road, after about an hour and a half, you will come to my hometown, South Bend, our Midwestern city in between the factories and the fields on the bend of the St. Joe River. Diverse from day one, South Bend saw an industrial heyday that lasted into the 1960s, and then, like so many cities of the so-called Rust Belt, we experienced a crushing decline as the auto factories left. By 2011, the year I ran for mayor, the national press said that we were one of America's 10 dying cities. I ran for mayor saying that the old economy would not come back, but we would if we had the courage to reimagine our future. And I am proud to report to you that now South Bend is back. Our city is growing, more people moving in than we've seen in a generation, thousands of new jobs, billions in investment. We are a good city, a proud city, and a growing city. We're also a city that has known its measure of pain, especially recently. As was mentioned, 2 weeks ago, a member of our community, a man named Eric Logan, a black man, lost his life at the hands of another member of our community, a white police officer. And our city's hurt has gone even beyond the grief of the family that lost one of their own. Even as we wait for outside investigators to deliver their judgment on what took place, we have a pain now that reminds us that our community lives around a chasm, a racial gulf in which black residents and white residents experience every facet of life differently. So at a time like this, I might point to all of the hard work we've done over 7 years around things like police professionalism and accountability, things from bias and de-escalation to changing our approach to officer recruitment, training, and promotion, but events compel me to acknowledge that whatever we've done has not been nearly enough. As long as a traffic stop is a completely different experience for a black driver than it is for a white driver, we know we have not done nearly enough. We know that as long as police departments, and this is true of my own, do not reflect the community they serve in their makeup, we have not done enough. We had a very emotional town hall meeting, and one woman told me that her 7-year-old grandson has already learned to fear the police. She said that's not what's supposed to happen in America, or in Indiana, or anywhere in 2019. And she's right. And we accept responsibility, I accept responsibility, for the work that is left to be done. So in the wake of that tragedy, we've been redoubling our partnership with community and civil rights leaders, tearing down walls of mistrust, reassessing policing and oversight, redesigning training, reimagining recruiting, and transforming relationships. We are underway on that right now. And I believe in our plan, and I believe in my city. And I believe we will come together to struggle and repair and come out stronger in the broken places. This will be a painful process, and not only for black residents who feel left behind and lied to far too many times, but also for law enforcement community that's going to have to face some hard truths. Recently, I warned newly sworn in police officers that their work takes place in the shadow of systemic racism, and the union felt it was disparaging. I intended no disparagement. My point was that every police officer, and for that matter, every citizen, and most certainly every mayor, lives within this shadow, which means everyone has to be part of the solution. Now, when a white elected official or politician is confronted with racial concerns, pundits often go right to the political terms, and we see articles about a white politician's black problem. I am asked how I'm going to earn the black vote in the polls 10 times more often than I am asked how my policies would actually benefit black Americans. It's as if I'm being asked more about how to win than how to deserve to win. But that is our focus. Because this is deeper than politics. This is not just a political problem, and it is not just a police problem, and it is not just my problem or my city's problem, and it is certainly not just a black problem. This is an American problem, and it requires nationwide American solutions. Now, I'm running for president as mayor of an American city, admittedly not a traditional move, but I'm doing it because we need national politics to rediscover its local basis, to recognize that the toughest local issues both cause and reflect our most urgent national issues. We are living in shadows cast through time and across the country, and policing is only part of the story. Yes, the uniform is burdened by racism, but it goes far beyond that. Our healthcare system is burdened by racism. If black women are dying three times as often from maternal complications as white women, if, as we just heard, that here in Chicago, there is an enormous disparity in life expectancy from one neighborhood to another. We know that our housing is burdened by racism, the result of intentional policies, local and national, that segregated our neighborhoods by race, and when they could no longer be enforced by law, they were enforced by bureaucracy and by intimidation. Our schools are burdened by racism, not just in the history that led to Brown versus Board, but in the fact that in the years since, our schools remain segregated. All of American life takes place under these shadows, not as some distant historical artifact, but as a burning present reality that hurts everyone and everything it touches. And if we do not tackle the problem of racial inequality in my lifetime, I am convinced that it will upend the American project in my lifetime. It brought our country to its knees once, and if we do not act, it could again. And so I believe this is not only a matter of justice, but a matter of national survival. Now, for some time, most of the policy debate around race has taken place under the polite assumption that if we simply delete a racist policy and replace it with a neutral policy, then inequality will sort of work its way out of the system and take care of itself. But it doesn't work that way, does it? Left without remedy, and injustice does not heal, it compounds. Since this is a business audience, I'm going to take the liberty of discussing math, specifically the mathematics of compound interest. So everyone here knows, you business people, business leaders know that a dollar today, if we assume 5% interest, a dollar today will double into $2 in less than 20 years. By that same law of compounding, after 50 years, that $1 has become $10. After 100 years, it's more than $100. And after 150 years, it is more than $1,000. That $1, by the magic of compound interest, turns into $1,000. This is true of the value over time of a dollar saved, which means it is also true of the value over time of a dollar stolen. Every dollar plundered 150 years ago cost the descendants of the victim $1,000 today. So each year we do not act, the bill grows larger and the costs cut deeper. And contrary to what some are saying in politics, what this means is that the fact that some, and only some, but the fact that some of this theft came a very long time ago doesn't make it better, it makes it worse. Now, the policies that created these inequities were put in place intentionally. So that means it's going to take intentional action to reverse those harms, bold and meaningful action that addresses not only the question of safety, but also the question of prosperity, knowing that the two cannot be separated one from another. That is why I agree with Reverend Jackson when he said that police reforms can only be meaningful if they happen in the context of a comprehensive policy. And it's also why I believe we need to invest in the future of Black America with a plan as ambitious as the Marshall Plan that rebuilt Europe after World War II. We could call it the Douglas Plan. Now, the values that motivate my campaign, freedom, security, democracy, these values will not be real for any of us until they are realized for all of us. And it's going to take extra effort applying our deepest values and our biggest ideas to drive out the darkness. And it is, candidly, particularly urgent that we hear this from any candidate who runs for office with the benefits and privileges of whiteness on his or her side. So let's talk about freedom in its truest sense. I want this to be the election when we finally break the spell that has many believing that freedom is a conservative value. Freedom is an American value with progressive implications, because freedom entails having access to healthcare. You're not free if you can't start that small business because you're afraid that leaving your old job would mean losing your healthcare. Healthcare is freedom too. You're not free as a woman if your reproductive rights are being dictated by male politicians. You're not free if you're not well educated, which is why the next president needs to appoint a Secretary of Education who believes in public education. We're not free unless everyone who seeks to go to college can afford to go to college, and everyone who doesn't go to college can still afford to make a good living on their wages, which is why we need a higher minimum wage. And of course, none of us can be free if any of us does not experience justice from our justice system. No one is free if any among us are disproportionately policed, surveilled, and locked up. If an American can be released from incarceration only to find himself confined in a paperwork checkbox that boxes you out of housing and employment, all of us are worse off. I believe we can and must achieve a 50% reduction in incarceration in this country without an increase in crime. We can do it by legalizing marijuana and eliminating incarceration for simple drug possession. We can do it by abolishing private federal prisons and putting an end to petty fines and fees that criminalize poverty. You should not be locked up simply for being poor, and no one should become rich by locking poor people up. So let's invest in rehabilitation and reentry, ensuring that incarcerated Americans have quality health care and Pell Grants to access an education, that they can access housing upon release so that they can get back on their feet. That's an investment not only in them, but in all of us. All of us will be better off. And yes, we will do everything in our power to ensure that police are professional and accountable. With a civil rights division at the Department of Justice that is invigorated and empowered to deal with civil rights, and legislation to raise standards for use of force and civilian oversight. This is part of what 21st century freedom must look like. But it's also a question of economic freedom, not just freedom from, but freedom to. As important as criminal justice reform is, we have got to outgrow a policy debate that sometimes reduces the Black experience in our country to encounters with the justice system. For every mention of black victimization in the justice system, we should also be speaking of black empowerment through education and entrepreneurship, like what people here work on every day. For every discussion of so-called black problems, there should be just as much about black solutions. And this is where the business community gathered here comes in. Because those gathered here know that economic empowerment requires everything from a good start in life to widespread policy support for minority-owned businesses. And I was taking notes about some of the different ways that that support does not always come true in our present reality. In South Bend, this is why we've been investing in a new generation of entrepreneurs. We started early with digital literacy resources, access to technology, free Wi-Fi downtown and in community centers and in public housing. It's why we've expanded quality for early childhood care, lifted up young leaders of color tackling serious issues on our youth task force. We've elevated the role of minority-owned businesses in driving wealth creation. We established a small business incubator in a historically black neighborhood, invested in infrastructure and facade improvements for small businesses, trained women and minority contractors. We ordered up a disparity study on our city's purchasing from minority-owned businesses precisely because we know the numbers are not as good as we would like, and knowing that we cannot reach or even set ambitious targets until we face the truth, make a plan, and make good on our plans. But we are committed to using the city's economic influence for change and taking a clear-eyed look at how we can drive wealth generation. We haven't solved our issues overnight where I come from, but we are taking concrete action and we've seen real movement. And I want to bring that same sense of concrete action to the federal level. That's why I am proposing that the United States triple the number of entrepreneurs from underserved areas, particularly those of color within 10 years. This would create over 3 million jobs and $660 billion in new wealth in black communities around our country. I also propose we set up a federal fund, and we know it can be done because there are programs in states like Maryland that do this, to co-invest in entrepreneurs of color, particularly in low-income communities. We've heard just this morning about the ways in which access to capital are a barrier for what would be viable minority enterprises. So let us reform credit scoring, increase access to credit, and support long-term growth. If we do that, I know that we can increase the number of small businesses in the black community by at least 50%. And we know that the federal government could do better when it comes to its own contracting, which is why we will set a target of awarding 25% of federal business to minority and women-owned firms. Freedom is more than freedom from, it's freedom to. And security is more than the kinds of things I dealt with when I was in uniform in the military. It's economic security. That's part of national security. Security is a bit like freedom. It's one of those things conservatives talk about like they own it. But in the 21st century, real security is going to take a little more imagination than just putting up a wall from coast to coast. We got to talk about cybersecurity and election security, especially when hostile foreign actors are using racial division as a national security vulnerability. It means, if we are serious about security, that we will name and confront a rising tide of violent white nationalism that is claiming lives here at home and abroad. It means naming climate disruption as the national security challenge that it is. One whose impacts, by the way, disproportionately fall on low-income communities and communities of color. And security, national security, means ensuring that the Second Amendment cannot become a death sentence in suburban schools or on the streets of our cities because Washington cannot deliver common sense gun reform that the American people want. So I'm determined that we break the spell that has people believing that security is a conservative value, that freedom is a conservative value. And while we're at it, it is time for us also to remind America that God does not belong to any political party. And that if we really want to walk in the way that our faith traditions teach us, we might pay a little more attention to the command of Scripture that says, I was hungry and you fed me. I was a prisoner and you visited me. I needed clothes and you clothed me. That should be our North Star, whether you are religious or not. Now, for any of these issues to be tackled, we got to pay attention to one more American value that gets talked about a lot but isn't always made good on, and that is democracy. Are we a democracy? Are we in our democratic republic democratic enough? I don't think we're a democracy if some people are systematically restricted from voting because one party has decided that it will be better off if fewer people vote. When a state like North Carolina targeted black voters with what a court decision described as surgical precision. We got to make it easier, not harder to vote. And that means reforms like instituting automatic voter registration, expanding early voting and vote by mail, and simple things like making Election Day a national holiday. And for the 6 million Americans denied a voice because of a felony conviction, let's truly welcome them back into society upon their return and restore their right to vote without any fees, without any hoops, without any steps, without what they're doing in Florida that amounts to a modern-day poll tax. We need reform for a Supreme Court that's coming to look more and more political by the day. We need reform at a time when districts are still drawn so that politicians choose their voters rather than the other way around. And yes, I would argue in the world's greatest democracy, if we wish to be worthy of the name, we just might want to start picking our nation's leader by counting up all the votes and giving it to the person who got the most. Your vote in Illinois and my vote in Indiana would count more if we did that. So, we know that we have got a long way to go in my community and in our country. To understand the ways in which these political abstractions cash out in our everyday lives, to recognize that not only is all politics local, it is personal for all of us in different ways. In 1963, on the anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation, James Baldwin wrote his nephew that America was celebrating 100 years of freedom, 100 years too soon. I was rereading Baldwin recently, and I asked myself, if America, as of 1963, had not made good on that promise 100 years on, what are we going to say in 2063, 100 years after Baldwin wrote that and 100 years after Dr. King shared his dream? Will we or will we not have tackled those inequities before it is too late? 2063 isn't that far off. In fact, it is closer to today than 1963. We are nearer to that date than we are to the Civil Rights March. God willing, I'll be around to see it. I'd be in my early 80s. And so I'm asking myself what my kids might say to me about these moments we're living in right now. In 2063, those now in grade school, on the west side of South Bend or the south side of Chicago, will be in their professional prime. So when I meet them at the tables that they are sponsoring at this breakfast, I want to have a good answer about what we did in 2020 to get ready for 2063. This week, we're marking the birthday of a country we have learned to love without illusions. To love even as we know that its founding included slavery, not as a peculiar feature off to the side, but as such a fundamental element of its political economy that it could not be extricated without the conflagration of the Civil War. In a country that today, in 2019, still amounts to two different places for people who are black and people who are white. So the lives and livelihoods of millions of people, not distant descendants far off, but people who are alive this minute, depend on whether we resolve this in our time. I am conscious of standing in a room with leaders from a generation that delivered unbelievable advances and did so at an unbelievable cost. Now I am conscious of the task before my generation, and I am determined that that generation, the most diverse yet in American history, be the one to fully deliver on Dr. King's dream, that we might live to celebrate a 4th of July, finally free from the bitter ironies that led Frederick Douglass to ask what a holiday like that even meant to someone like him, that in 2063 we could look back and say that in these years, now, we set our nation on a better path, and that the ugliness and the anguish that we saw around us were nothing but the death throes of bigotry and divisiveness and intolerance, that they reared their head powerfully one last time, but were no match for the moral enemy, the moral energy of a committed people, no match for the action of those who saw before it was too late, that now was our last best chance at a more perfect union, and acted to make it so. I am here to do my part, to act to make it so, and I hope that you will join me in that effort. Thank you very much, and I will see you on the trail. Thank you. Thank you.